So welcome everyone. We have our today's speaker, Dr. Craig Hardgrove, who's an assistant professor at the School of Earth and Space Exploration at Arizona State University. He received his bachelor's in physics from Georgia Institute of Technology and PhD from University of Tennessee. He's a planetary geologist who's expert in science and exploration of Moon and Mars. And he's also the PI for Lunar Polar Hydrogen Mapper CubeSat mission. Today he's going to talk about lunar water with the LunaH-Map mission. So please take it away.
All right, thanks so much for having me. And I'm excited to talk to you guys about LunaH-Map today. This is actually, it's an engineering model of our complete spacecraft. So LunaH-Map is an example of a new type of NASA mission. And it's much smaller than the traditional NASA missions that you might be used to. So I'll talk about sort of the evolution of this type of spacecraft and where LunaH-Map fits in, and hopefully kind of leave you with some of the things that I think might be exciting that these types of spacecraft can do in the future. But just to give you a sense, so this box here is the size of about two large cereal boxes that you might buy at the grocery store. The circular unit that you can see sort of pointing at you at the base of the spacecraft is it's a gimbaled thruster. So that's about the size of a tissue box that you might have in your house. And that contains solid iodine that we heat and shoot out the back of the spacecraft to provide very low thrust that enables us to get into lunar orbit with this very small spacecraft. And then inside this box, we have the primary instrument payloads, the only instrument, which is a neutron detector, which I'll tell you about. We have a deep space radio. We have a command and data handling system that includes reaction wheels, a star tracker. We have batteries, power management system. And you can see the solar arrays deployed there, which are actually, they rotate on a small gimbal so that we can keep them pointed at the sun during operations. So all of the large components that you would expect to find on a normal NASA mission, full size, you know, school bus size spacecraft are in here. You just lose the size and you lose redundancy. Often those missions have multiple layers of redundancy throughout. And on a mission like this, you don't have the mass, the power, the volume for those types of things. So this is just all around a new type of mission, but it's very small and it can be accommodated on many different launch vehicles. So we actually just were placed onto the NASA mission, the Science Mission Directorate's quote fleet charts, what they call it. So all of their science missions are listed here throughout the solar system. And just for the moon, LunaH-Map appears. And as of, I think, last week, there's another small spacecraft called Lunar Trailblazer, which will also make an appearance on this chart. And so this is showing us next to Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. And just again, to give you a sense, I tried to scale this appropriately based on the pixel size of Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter versus, you know, LunaH-Map in this image. That's kind of the actual size of one LunaH-Map spacecraft compared to Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. So we're talking about a, you know, very, very small spacecraft. 10 centimeters by 20 centimeters by 30 centimeters is the main dimensions for the spacecraft body. And if you're not familiar with this as a concept, these are called CubeSats. This is one of the very first CubeSats that flew in space, called PhoneSat. And the idea for CubeSats as a form factor came from a Beanie Baby box. If you remember those, these concepts or form factors came out maybe 15 years ago, back when Beanie Babies were very popular. And a professor was looking at a Beanie Baby box that was a toy for his granddaughter, and said, you know, this designing a spacecraft component to fit inside this Beanie Baby box would be a very challenging engineering exercise for my engineering students. And so engineers love to work within constraints that they're given. And so this would be a volume constraint, and to some degree a mass constraint. So Over the 10 to 15 years from then to now, students at universities all across the country have developed all of the components that I started off mentioning that are inside LunaH-Map. They developed small reaction wheels, small power systems, small solar arrays, and originally they just fit into one of these boxes. And then at some point, people got the idea, well, why don't we just stack the boxes? And so you can stack them into what's called, one of these is called a U, one unit, one CubeSat unit. And then there are three U's. There are, LunaH-Map is six U, so six of these boxes stacked together. And when you stack the boxes together, you can put more and more components together and you can build a spacecraft. And that's not the only fundamental design difference between this type of mission and a NASA mission. The other one is the one I've put in the text on this slide, which is that you always, with these university developed missions, you design a system, you build it, you test it, you fly it, and then you retest it. So these types of systems became more and more reliable over 10 to 15 years because they were able to do this iterative process of the design. It wasn't built in a mindset where there's only one mission every decade, so we'd better get it right. The idea was, let's build something that we think will work. We'll do the best we can under the constraints, usually budget or a semester project for students, and then we'll fly it and we'll see how well it works. And then when we learn something from that, we'll fly it again. And so the success rates for these types of CubeSats vary quite a bit, depending on whether or not it's a university-developed CubeSat or if it's something that comes from industry or a national lab. But they're nonetheless a compelling way of designing a mission. And with about 5 or 6 years ago, NASA was looking into ways to do this for planetary science missions. How might we use this new kind of paradigm to design a planetary science mission? So these are 3U CubeSats. These are Planet Labs, what are called doves. They're about the size of a bread loaf that image the Earth twice a day at resolutions of about 5 meters per pixel. There's an entire company that's formed based on launching about 80 to 100 of these per launch into orbit around the Earth and imaging the entirety of the Earth and then selling the data or providing the data to researchers. So there's a lot that you can do with these tiny CubeSats. And these are actually being deployed from the International Space Station, which was one of the primary deployment mechanisms for these early CubeSats. But we're talking here about planetary science. So you may remember not that long ago, the InSight lander landed at Mars, and riding along with the InSight lander were 2 CubeSats, the same size as LunaH-Map. These are 6U CubeSats, that their primary goal was to relay all of the entry, descent, and landing data for the InSight lander back to Earth. And the reason for that was because the orbiters around Mars were not going to be able to relay all of the InSight data back to Earth for some time after InSight had landed, many days. And if Marco could successfully fly over the landing site as InSight landed, we would be able to immediately get the data from InSight back with the delay, 7-minute delay. And they were able to maneuver themselves into position using a small propulsion system, deploy what you see there, which are called reflector arrays. Mars is much further away from the moon, so they actually need a larger antenna in order to beam back their signal to the DSN, or the Deep Space Network. And so that's what Marco's primary mission was, and both Marcos executed that mission flawlessly. So I'll take the models of Marco out because those weren't real, but this picture is real. So this is what the Marco spacecraft took, a picture of Mars on its way flying by after it had completed its primary mission. And I speak fairly regularly with the PI of Marco, Andy Klesch. He's helped tremendous help on our mission. And, he is quoted here as saying, Marco is just a herald of new things to come. And these are not necessarily better things. They're just different. And it's a new way of exploring space that is going to complement all of these larger missions. And I firmly believe that this is, I don't think necessarily CubeSats have any intention of replacing or really should replace the larger missions, but as ride-alongs, with larger missions, the hope is that they can enable new, compelling, potentially risky data collections that we might not otherwise be inclined to do with our much larger spacecraft. So I talked to Andy and he said, you know, the reason they have this picture off-centered, they could have centered Mars in the picture. They off-centered it because they wanted all this blanks to, I guess, elucidate with people thinking about this, you know, where might these CubeSats go next? It's not necessarily to Mars. It's elsewhere in the solar system to sort of perform these exciting missions. And Marco truly was the first. So LunaH-Map, you know, where does this fit in? This was a call that was released in 2014, I believe. It was the first simplex call. The mission I mentioned, Lunar Trailblazer, is one of the second round of simplex missions that was selected. Those are much larger missions. They're actually ESPA class, so these are 150 kilogram spacecraft, as compared to the first simplex call, which called for 6U or smaller missions that go up to 14 kilograms in mass. So this is very, very small. And we have a science objective of mapping hydrogen enrichments within and outside permanently shadowed regions. That's what is called PSRs there, at the lunar south pole at spatial scales of less than 20 square kilometers. This would improve upon the maps that were made previously by Lunar Prospector, and it would complement the maps that have been made by Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter LEND, which is also another neutron detector that was sent to orbit the moon. And in order to achieve the mission, we have to demonstrate deep space propulsion navigation in order to get ourselves into orbit around the moon, and we have to operate the spacecraft and collect our science data in orbit around the moon. I won't dwell too much on this slide, but I guess if I have time for questions later, I've already, I guess, alluded to a lot of this, but you know, when people think about why make something smaller, there's the practical reason, which is that it's very tiny and it's less massive. And if you can achieve the same functionality with these small components that you can with the larger components, why not make them smaller? But you know, what I mentioned with these university-built CubeSats in the original sort of CubeSat form factor, I think still rings true, at least for missions like LunaH-Map or Marco, or missions that are in this very small size, but also in a very small budget range. If you're familiar with NASA mission classes, there's class A through D, and I've put some example budget ranges for those. LunaH-Map and Marco are sitting at, you know, 2% of a traditional NASA mission at most. And so while there's a lot of risk categorization and other sort of mission assurance guidelines that go into the class A through D missions, a lot of that is being defined right now by missions like Marco and like LunaH-Map. And so, you know, we don't necessarily know how to fit these into the overall profile, but it's a worthwhile exercise to try to figure it out. So I think, you know, we don't not test. We test every component we have, and we test them in all of the critical mission scenarios that we can. And so you reduce the risk on these missions where you can, and the mission overall needs to be commensurate with a high risk, high reward complementary science goal. In the case of Marco, if Marco did not send back the in-site entry, descent, and landing data, we would have received that data anyway, several days or weeks later. In the case of LunaH-Map, having this high-resolution complementary data to a mission like Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter or Lunar Prospector would enable you to understand the global maps that were made by the primary neutron detectors that are on the main spacecraft a bit better. So these, you know, but and then I'll talk more about LunaH-Map and the mission profile, but you know, I think these types of missions, if you think about them as ride-alongs for future missions, if you bake in these risky things, whether that's the technology itself or whether it's something on the mission like flying at a very low altitude in the case of LunaH-Map over the South Pole, you can find yourself in a place where you can provide really complementary beneficial science data. And then you're okay with the risk that comes along with being, you know, something less than class D. So anyway, I'll stop there, but, you know, I kind of have to live that every day on this mission. So, you know, dealing with budgets and schedules and all that sort of stuff. So I'll talk about just the science and where this fits in. So these are a few of the neutron detector missions that have carried neutron detectors to planetary bodies in the solar system. In the upper left is the Dawn mission, which mapped Ceres and Vesta and the hydrogen enrichments throughout the surfaces of those planetary bodies. In the top middle is Mars Odyssey, which also carried a neutron detector, made global maps of Mars water. You can see both the poles in those maps. The upper right is a messenger mission to Mercury. We also saw polar hydrogen enrichments at the South Pole of Mercury, or sorry, the North Pole of Mercury. On the bottom two images are Lunar Prospector and Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, which carried neutron instruments to the moon. And like I've been mentioning, the purpose of sending a neutron detector into orbit around another planetary body is to map hydration. And the primary hydration-bearing molecule is water in the solar system, whether that's ice or liquid water. In most of these cases, it's ice. And so we map the planetary body usually at a regional scale. Regional meaning these instruments are not optical. You can think of them like a Geiger counter. So they're really mapping at the scale of, you know, tens to hundreds of kilometers. It's proportional to the altitude that the spacecraft is orbiting above the surface. So the closer you can get the spacecraft to the surface, the higher resolution or spatial resolution of the map that you can make. Most of these spacecraft didn't want to get very low to the surface because they carry many science instruments that don't want to do that, or it's a risky maneuver. So if you're not familiar with neutron detectors, I won't dwell too much on this slide, but really the fundamental principle is that galactic cosmic rays are bathing the entire solar system in high energy protons. If you don't have a thick atmosphere, those high energy protons get down all the way to the surface and they create high energy neutrons in the surface. That's what's shown here in these green and yellow lines. These are interactions of those high energy protons with the nuclei that are in the planetary surface. And when you generate high energy neutrons, they really just bounce around, like you could think of them like ping pong balls. Just classical mechanics, if a ping pong ball hits another ping pong ball, it loses about half of its energy. If a ping pong ball hits a bowling ball, it really just bounces off in the opposite direction and retains its kinetic energy. So that's the principle behind mapping hydrogen with a neutron detector. If you can make a map of the low energy component of the neutrons that are leaking out of a planetary surface, it's a great proxy for how much hydrated material is beneath the detector. And you can see here you generate gamma rays as well through these interactions. Those gamma rays can tell you about the characteristic elements that make up the planetary surface. So lunar water. This is not what I mean when I say lunar water. We don't expect to find a lake or even an ice skating rink. It seems likely that, or probable, that most of this hydrogen that we're talking about is adsorbed between grains. And it's been remobilized over time into these regions of permanent shadow. Gets deposited on the surface of the moon through water-bearing comets or asteroids. And the places that it's stable, this is a picture taken by Elrock of the south pole of the moon, and this is a crater rim. You can see that the light is illuminating the side of the crater rim on the left side of the image, and almost no light gets into the crater itself. And so these regions are some of the coldest in the entire solar system. We're talking about negative 400 degrees Fahrenheit or colder. And so these are the only real places on the moon, which has no atmosphere, where we would find water to be stable. And that's where we do see with many of the other instruments that we've sent, enrichments, you know, signs of enrichments of water and water ice within these regions of permanent shadow. So this is just a bit about the thermal environment. These are temperature maps made with the Diviner instrument on LRO. And you can see, you know, these cold traps in purple get extremely cold. And these are the places where we would expect these hydrogen-bearing phases to be concentrated at the south pole of the moon. You can take those data and look at the thermal properties of the lunar regolith, and you can come up with maps like this. The regions in white are areas where ice should be stable at the surface of the moon, just based on the thermal properties. And regions in red and green are places where we would expect the ice to be stable within the top meter of the moon. And these are places that a neutron detector is sensitive to. So unlike other instrumentation that tends to look at the optical surface of the planet, so microns of thickness, neutron detectors integrate down to a meter. And so we can see if there's an enrichment in these hydrated phases down to a meter, which is a unique capability of these detectors. And this is another example. This is a frost map made with LRO lamp instrument. And you can see that, so I've labeled here the regions in red are the regions of permanent shadow. The regions in blue are the places where the LRO lamp instrument has seen enrichments of frosts. These are hydrated frosts. And so you can see there's places where we would expect ice to be stable at the surface, but we see no frost. There are places where we do see frosts in places where we expect ice to be stable at the surface. But there's not consistency throughout these maps. In addition, like I mentioned, we've sent neutron detectors in the past at higher altitudes than what LunaH-Map will orbit from. But this is a map made with Lunar Prospector. The spatial scale here is on the order of 50 to 75 square kilometers per pixel. But you can see here there are enrichments in hydrogen in red up to about 200 micrograms per gram. I should say micrograms per gram, sorry for the typo. It's not milligrams per gram. And you can see near Cabeus in the upper left quadrant, there are enrichments. But generally, everything is smeared for the most part. It doesn't appear that there are discrete hydrogen enrichments within the regions of permanent shadow that I showed, say, on the previous map where it's labeled in red. Skip ahead. So you can do some things, some really interesting things with the data from Lunar Prospector, which has been done here. You can deconvolve the data. You can say, well, if we assume that the hydrogen is only within the regions of permanent shadow, what would the abundance of hydrogen have to be in order to produce the map that we see here? And so in this deconvolution, you can see that the amount of hydrogen has gone up. It's actually, in some cases, up to 1,000 micrograms per gram when you assume that all of the hydrogen is contained within the regions of permanent shadow. And that may or may not be true. That's just an assumption. It could be that in the Lunar Prospector map, there are enrichments of hydrogen somewhere in the top meter of the lunar surface, but they aren't within regions of permanent shadow. And those are contributing to the relatively broad spatial footprint that was made by, and the maps that were made by Lunar Prospector. So LCROSS was a mission that actually crashed into the Cabeus region. I'm pointing to that in the upper left there. And they did that on purpose, which was to kick up a plume of dust and determine how much, what was the composition of that dust. And the data implied that there were 5 to 10,000 parts per million or micrograms per gram hydrogen within that region. And that was a very small region. It was much smaller than the spatial sensitivity of Lunar Prospector. So really what this told us is that at these small spatial scales, at the tens of meters to hundreds of meters spatial scale, it might be that the distribution of hydrogen is heterogeneous, and we don't really understand it. So this is sort of where LunaH-Map plays in. Is, you know, here's the map from Lunar Prospector, the map of the permanently shadowed regions on the right, and then here's some other data sets that, you know, I mentioned the deconvolution in the middle. Really, the purpose here is to try to resolve, you know, or help resolve or constrain the discrepancy between these data sets. The one on the left that I haven't discussed is the LEND instrument map, which is from Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. And I just pulled this up here to show that the enrichments in dark blue are not wholly consistent with the deconvolution results or where we would expect ice to be present at the surface from these ice stability maps. So all of the data sets that we have don't always appear to be internally consistent. So if we had neutron maps at a lower spatial resolution, or a resolution that allowed us to resolve one permanently shadowed region from another, we would be able to say whether or not that enrichment is confined to within the permanently shadowed region, or if we might find enrichments of hydrogen outside those regions of permanent shadow where we might expect ice to be stable in the top meter. And that's important both for the evolution of volatiles on the moon, understanding how volatiles have evolved and mobilized over time throughout geologic history on the moon. And it's also important for future human exploration and robotic exploration of the moon. If there's a region that's not in permanent shadow that we could land that would enable us to access regions that might be enriched in volatiles, that might be a great place to go, because these regions of permanent shadow, as I mentioned, are relatively hard to access from an engineering perspective and a landing perspective. So, okay, so just now I'll jump in, talk specifically about LunaH-Map. So here's an example ground track from LunaH-Map. We'll make 282 of these passes throughout our mission. And you can see the altitude in the bottom right. And the important thing is the plot in the top right, which is the contribution of the region of permanent shadow to the neutron signal that LunaH-Map will observe. And you can see here, it's actually covered by my, believe it's somewhere sitting close to 80%. Previous missions, we were not getting nearly that much contribution from the regions of permanent shadow. So we're seeing, you know, between 60 and 80% for the region the permanently shadowed region of Shoemaker. I think, yeah, I might have another here just to show. Well, everything slowed down quite a bit for me. Okay, in yellow, there's a smaller region of permanent shadow in the bottom left quadrant. And you can see here, we're still achieving about 60% contribution from the region of permanent shadow. And I'll show you, you know, we can then propagate this through our instrument response function and what we might expect to see if there were hydrogen enrichments confined to these regions. Would we be able to resolve one from another? So I'll show you that map in just a bit. Okay. So here are some of the regions that we will fly over and be able to constrain the hydrogen distribution of. I've highlighted on the right plot, these circled regions are areas where with Lunar Prospector in the upper right, we see an enrichment of hydrogen, but we don't see a corresponding abundance, spatial distribution abundance of regions of permanent shadow that would indicate we would that would explain why we see that enrichment in that area. And conversely, in the bottom left quadrant, there's a region where we don't see significant enrichment of hydrogen with the neutron spectrometer on Lunar Prospector, but we do see relatively large regions of permanent shadow. And so this is, again, getting at the discrepancies that we'd like to resolve or help resolve with LunaH-Map. So here's our 282 ground tracks. We'll be in a 4.76-hour orbit. It's a highly elliptical orbit. That's the only way we can maintain a stable orbit with our relatively weak or very weak propulsion system, low thrust. So we execute periodic trajectory correction maneuvers at Apolloon when we're going the slowest and make sure that we just control for the altitude. So the spacecraft is controlled either up or down to make sure that we aren't too weakly captured by the moon or that we don't obviously impact with the moon. And then we let the argument of periaps sweep across the moon throughout the 2 months of the science mission. And you see there we get reasonably good coverage of the regions of permanent shadow at the South Pole. So this is what I mentioned before. You can populate. We don't know whether or not the map on the left is correct, but you could go, you know, make some best guesses from previous instrument measurements of these regions of permanent shadow and populate them with varying, you know, amounts of microgram per gram hydrogen. And you can look at the map on the right. This is propagating LunaH-Map's orbit with our neutron detector over the 56-day mission or all 282 orbits. And the purpose of this chart is not to say this is what we're going to see. We don't know what we'll see, but it's to demonstrate that if the enrichments are confined to these regions of permanent shadow, LunaH-Map will be able to resolve one region from another. So LunaH-Map can detect these expected hydrogen concentrations. If there's greater enrichments, we would be able to see them easier in less time. But these are reasonable estimates to begin with. We resolve the PSRs. That means that we can tell the boundaries, but we likely will not be able to reconstruct the actual amount of microgram per gram hydrogen that's within the region of permanent shadow. And that's because the spatial footprint is still very large. So we don't necessarily, we can estimate the bulk abundance at the 10 to 15 square kilometer scale, But locally, it may be much more than that at regions of, like, say, a landing site or something like that, or maybe less than that. But the purpose here is really to say, you know, is it confined to the PSRs or not? So these low altitude measurements will enable us to make high spatial resolution maps of the PSRs in the surrounding regions where we might expect hydrogen to be stable in the top meter. And then, like I mentioned before, if a mission like this had flown along with Lunar Prospector or Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, this would be invaluable data for understanding the maps that were created from both of those missions. So I think that, you know, when we think about these types of missions before, or looking forward, this is something that, you know, a type of mission that could ride along with a mission that's going to explore a new planetary body and make maps of hydrogen. So, but regardless, you know, we will be able to use the maps from LunaH-Map to reinterpret the maps that were made by Lunar Prospector and Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. So just to summarize some of the science objectives, there may be these thick subsurface ice deposits pervasive at high latitudes. And it may be that they're remobilized by impacts and then buried. There's some morphologic evidence to suggest that in these simple craters. And then it's possible that through impact gardening, you've vertically redistributed the ice, and that it's still stable in the top meter, that, you know, outside of these regions of permanent shadow. And so that's in some ways very important to understand, and just as important to understand as the, you know, how much ice is within the regions of permanent shadow themselves. So as I mentioned before, the, you know, shallow ice frost maps are not necessarily consistent with the regions where we see bulk hydrogen enriched with previous instruments. So LunaH-Map will be able to help us constrain that and help better understand that by, you know, helping to understand whether or not the distribution of hydrogen is consistent with the expected permafrost depth distributions or frost distributions. And is hydrogen potentially enriched in these regions where we see ice might be stable or isn't stable, but we see enrichments with previous instruments. Okay, so just now to finish up, just talking some about the LunaH-Map spacecraft. This is the spacecraft and all the components. We're 14 kilogram spacecraft. The solar arrays, they are stowed. We go into a deployer when we're stowed into the rocket, and then the deployer opens and we are pushed out on a push plate that's spring loaded. And when we deploy, those arrays spread out, and when they're deployed, they're about a meter to a meter and a half wide. So they're very large arrays, and they're intended to power the propulsion system. So we get about 90 watts beginning of life for those arrays. The propulsion system uses about 65 watts when it's thrusting. And so those arrays need to be sun pointed to power the propulsion system during our cruise and transition into lunar orbit. We're using the same deep space transponder IRIS that was used by the Marco spacecraft, and it's used by many of the other CubeSats on the Artemis 1 mission and a Blue Canyon command data handling system. And this is the other fun part of the project is we looked into different ways to make the neutron measurements that we needed to make, and none of them really made us as happy as building our own new neutron detector. Which was a challenge, but this is the finished flight neutron detector. We called it the mini neutron detector. It's kind of a misnomer. It's oversized for most neutron detectors that fly on NASA missions. It's the only instrument on our spacecraft. It takes up almost a third of the entire spacecraft. That's because we needed a lot of surface area on such a short duration mission to make the measurements that we wanted to make, to get the signal to noise that we really wanted to achieve to make these measurements. So the entire face of the CubeSat is lined with this neutron sensitive material. It's a scintillator. And you can see here a little bit of the details. It's made up of an array. It's a 2x4 array of an alpacolite scintillator that's both gamma and neutron sensitive. And in the spirit of CubeSats, we decided in part by necessity, but also in part in the spirit of CubeSats, we made the instrument modular. So each electronics board for the instrument can power up to four of these modules that you see here in the middle. And so you could, for a future mission, only send one of those modules if you perhaps have a small rover that has the ability to detect, you know, to make longer integration time measurements. In our case, we're flying over the surface of the moon at 2 kilometers a second. So we really need to collect as many neutrons as we can as we fly over to make quality maps. If you were on a stationary rover, you could integrate for a longer period of time with your instrument and use a smaller surface area instrument. So, you know, this is a modular design. You could add or subtract modules from the instrument. And so we wanted this to be something that for future CubeSat missions that may want to fly a neutron or gamma ray detector, this is something that we could adapt for those missions. We also calibrated the instrument at the same facility that was used for Lunar Prospector. And the mission, GRAND, the gamma ray and neutron detector on the Dawn mission, was calibrated at the Los Alamos Neutron Free and Air facility. It's a huge room that has a calibrated neutron source that you put the instrument on a stage that kind of hovers in the middle of the room, and you're able to make some really great measurements that allow you to understand the response of the detector much better than you would just in your lab. And that's us, the science team and engineering team at the facility with the instrument on a rotational stage in December of 2018, when we did that calibration. Here are solar arrays that were delivered. These are same design, although the cells are the same. And each panel design is the same as what flew on Marco. We just have more panels. And so the next slide, I believe, is the Iris radio. Yep, it's delivered from JPL. It's the same radio that flew on Marco with some upgrades. It's also flying again on all the Artemis 1 CubeSat missions. And this is the propulsion system. I mentioned it's the size of a tissue box. And that's our propulsion system in a hot fire test with our command and data handling system back prior to acceptance in December of 2019. So we did get some stick time with the propulsion system. Many, you know, tens of hours firing to make sure that all of our commands executed, got comfortable with the propulsion system before accepting delivery. That's just to give you, you know, again, a sense for how small all this is. That's me holding it. You should really never let the PI touch the hardware, but they wanted me to get a nice photo there holding the system. And then this is our flat sat bench. It's actually upgraded quite a bit since this photo was taken. We work with a small contractor in Arizona that's worked with a lot of spaceflight hardware before on some of the other instruments that have been developed out of ASU from Phil Christensen's group, the LTES instrument, EMIRS instrument. And so they are very familiar with flight hardware and working with the NASA flight standards. And so they're helping us with both the construction of the flat sat, which you can see here is many of our components have engineering models or emulators that we use to test a lot of the hardware prior to setting up the flight sequences on the bench. And that's also where we assembled all the flight hardware. This is our mission operations center at ASU. We're working with Kinetics for mission design and navigation. They provided the mission design navigation for the New Horizons program mission, which went to Pluto. They also working most recently with OSIRIS-REx, which was really exciting to see. And so they are really happy to be working with us, and they've been a great partner on the mission design, working through a lot of these low thrust trajectory maneuvers and making sure we'll be able to get into the right orbit. We're also partnered with Qualtech for the mission operations. So they're, again, a small company. They have a facility here in Phoenix, and they're building a lot of our ground data systems tools, our operations tools for the Mission Operations Center. I didn't talk too much about the orbit, but this is just a little quick overview. We deploy from SLS. I don't know if you can see my mouse, but right about here, this is the Earth. We deploy here, and then we execute a maneuver to do a lunar flyby that shoots us off out to the weak stability boundary. So that's the Lagrange point between the Earth and the Sun. And then we come back to the Moon. So you can see here in number one, we're coming back, meeting up with the Moon, and then we're weakly captured by the Moon in number two. And that's where we execute a long set of maneuvers to spiral down into the science orbit, which you see in number three. So that's the that whole process will take about a year. Depends on the Earth, Moon, Sun position of the SLS Artemis 1 launch date. And then this is the science orbit. So every 30 minutes at perilune, we acquire science data. Periodically, we will acquire science data at apolune when we aren't performing a trajectory maneuver. And then we are periodically in eclipse. There are not significant number of eclipses, only a handful throughout the 2 months. And they're also not very long in duration because of the highly elliptical orbit. And then we do comms and tracking in the wings of the orbit there. Okay, so where are we now? Just to wrap up, I won't go through the entire Gantt chart, but we are on schedule to deliver early next year. We had our TVAC testing just right before Christmas. We had a minor issue with the radio that actually required us to get some work done at the vendor. And so this schedule is now a bit out of date. I didn't have time to update it, but we'll be delivering in the March-April timeframe to SLS. And so this was the spacecraft prior to deintegration of the radio back in May. You can see the final assembled spacecraft right there with everything put together in the clean room. And I won't dwell too much on these things, but I'd be happy to talk more about them, you know, if anyone's interested. There are technical and non-technical challenges to a mission like this. You know, I mentioned already, you know, how to evaluate risk on a small program. There's the physical small size. There's also, you know, the fact that we're not the primary payload on the mission. So the primary payload for SLS Artemis 1 is the Orion capsule, which will, it's an unmanned mission, and it'll fly around the moon and splash land in the ocean. And so that is the primary mission. And so all decisions that are made about the trajectory of SLS are made first and foremost with the Orion capsule and, you know, that uncrewed mission moving forward. And so, you know, we don't get a lot of say as these secondary payloads go. It's, you know, a challenge. And I think that'll continue to be a challenge for these secondary payloads on small missions. So, you know, and it's an entirely new program for NASA. I already mentioned, you know, the first call for Simplex called for 14 kilogram spacecraft. The next call, Lunar Trailblazer, and the others that were selected are 150 kilogram spacecraft. The budget's also increased for that mission as well. So I think, you know, they're just, you know, challenges for everyone across the board. But I hope, and the reason I am harping on this, I guess, is that I hope that, you know, in the shakeup and in the thinking about this, these small missions like LunaH-Map and all of the Artemis 1 CubeSats, Lunar Flashlight, Lunar Ice Cube, NEA Scout, there's a handful of us that are all 6U and are trying to execute very exciting science missions on these new technologies. I hope they're not lost in the shuffle. And when we think about these really small missions, that there's a place for them moving forward in the overall portfolio of NASA missions. I'm not saying anything about these larger 150 kilogram missions. I think they're great. I just think we should be excited in thinking about these small ones too. Okay, and then I'm really proud of, you know, we don't have, you know, a lot of, you know, for a traditional university CubeSat. We are professionally designed. We have professional engineering staff, but we do engage with students. And I'm really proud of the students that we've had on this program, that we've been able to have, you know, work on our program and then go on. And I've just put some of the positions that they've found themselves in and been able to get moving forward. And they've really been able to use the opportunity to work with us and further their careers. And we still do have a few students working on the program, and it's great to see them. I think it's a unique opportunity that we have at a university to help foster, you know, future engineers and scientists. And Yeah, I've had that's our my son in the upper right, and some of our ops staff, they had a son as well, so we got them to pose next to the 3D print of the spacecraft back when they were the same size as the spacecraft. So been a lot of growth through the program. It's been interesting, and thank you for having me, and I'm happy to take any questions you have.
That's great. So if anyone has questions, then they can unmute themselves or type it in the chat box so that either I or Craig can read them out loud.
Sorry, I'm having some trouble scrolling. My computer, I guess, is having trouble.
Craig?
Yes.
Hi, it's Lisa. I'm a NASA JPL Solar System Ambassador, and there are some programs with robotics, and CubeSats are one of these items on the agenda. 3D printing. I love the photograph of your sons with the CubeSat up in the right side. Are these CubeSats created in 3D printing of a specific resin for the material, or?
So that model right there is not the actual spacecraft. That's just it's something we have in our lobby at ASU that we use for education and public outreach. It's 3D printed to size, but as far as 3D printed parts, I don't know if we actually have any 3D printed parts on the flight spacecraft. I would have to double check with our engineers, but if we do, they're very, very small and not any major load bearing components on the, they're not structural components on the spacecraft. So. I didn't mean to imply that the spacecraft was 3D printed there. That's just an EPO product that we have that we put the kids next to.
Okay. Gotcha. Thank you so much for sharing.
Yep.
We have a couple questions from the audience. Will LunaH-Map only be concerned about the poles, or are you looking at the global neutron data?
We will collect data at higher altitudes as we approach perilune. We do want to get some of the dry lunar highlands material so that we have a baseline for dry regolith count rates to compare the polar data to. We'll also collect data at apolune, primarily for background corrections that need to be made throughout the mission. But the data that we would collect at higher altitudes than, plus minus 75 south, shouldn't be any better spatial resolution than what was acquired with Lunar Prospector or Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. So, and we may not have the power budget on the spacecraft to keep the detector on for those portions of the orbit. So like I mentioned, we really only intend to have it on for about 20 or 30 minutes each orbit at perilune. And then the spacecraft has a lot of maintenance and charging the batteries and other activities that it needs to complete that might preclude us keeping the detector on throughout each orbit. So I think the short answer is, not really, but although we will have some data to look at for other portions of the moon.
Okay. The next question is, how will the mission end? Will you crash in the South Pole area? Will you get any useful data on the way in?
Yeah, the current plan is to crash into the South Pole. We had to submit a full planetary protection plan for that impact. We'll know much more about where we'll crash once we know the launch date and the final science orbit. I don't think we really intend to keep the detector on because we would have to then send the data back unless we can do real-time communication during the descent. But we have not looked into that yet. And I don't think there was some initial analysis. I think I could be wrong about this, but I think when LCROSS crashed into Cabeus, and that was almost an entire upper stage of a rocket. There was an attempt to see that impact from Earth. And I don't remember how successful that was, even with very powerful telescopes. And I even think, there was an attempt to see it with other spacecraft and it might not have happened. So that was a very large impact. And we're going to be, like I said, 14 kilograms and two cereal boxes. So I don't think there's much of a shot at anybody seeing us kicking up anything meaningful, but we can certainly look into it. And I hadn't really considered keeping the detectors on the way down, but if it looks like we would impact somewhere interesting, perhaps that might be something we could do.
Okay, I think Lisa has another question. Would you like to ask your question, Lisa?
Oh, yes, hi. Regarding the data collection that is to be acquired, will it be downlinked into petabytes for analysis and Python coding or GitHub repositories for researchers?
Yeah, so our intention is to provide all of the data to what's called the Planetary Data System, the PDS. So we've been in communication with the Geosciences PDS node out of WashU, and we'll have a complete set of data that gets archived on the PDS throughout, at the end of the mission, that will be available. There'll be documentation for how to read in those data and work with them and what they are. So yeah, that is our intention to do that on this mission, just like any other NASA mission.
Excellent, thank you so much.
Here is another question from the audience. Has this or a similar instrument collected data about the Earth as a test or proof of concept? Or do you plan to do that?
So neutron data of the Earth, primarily I think are used at this point for astronaut health and safety on board the International Space Station. There should be a neutron emission spectrum from the upper atmosphere of the Earth. But for science purposes, there's not a whole lot of meaningful data that I think we could get from a neutron spectrometer in orbit around the Earth. I'm sure someone on the line could correct me on that, but I haven't been able to come up with anything. We did, however, take an engineering model of this detector that we're sending on LunaH-Map. It's a smaller version of the detector, but it uses the same electronics and provided that to a University of Hawaii CubeSat called Neutron One. They just were deployed in, I believe, late November of last year. And so we're waiting to hear back on the spacecraft data. So that would have been a demonstration of this instrument. I believe that there are some published papers on high altitude balloon measurements that were made with this detector, as well as some other detectors, and showed that they performed reasonably well in the radiation environment. There have been some data collected with this instrument, but it hasn't been extensive.
Here is another question from the audience. In past missions using ion drive, the gas xenon was used as a propellant. Why was iodine chosen for the lunar propellant?
Right, yeah, we looked into xenon. Xenon requires, you store xenon as a gas. And in order to get the same delta V that we need for this mission, which is between 1600 and 1800 meters per second, you need the xenon tank needs to be a bit too large to fit into this 6U CubeSat form factor. It almost fits, but with all of the other stuff, the plenum tanks, the hosing, the hoses, the valves, all that stuff, it just wasn't going to fit. So the iodine has a higher ISP specific impulse than the xenon, and so you can use, it's a 1.5 to 2 kilogram solid block of iodine chips that sit in our fuel tank, and they fit into that kind of tissue box sized propulsion system. So that was the only solution that we were aware of at the time when we began designing the spacecraft that would fit in this form factor. If you could send a 12U or a 24U spacecraft, I think then you could start thinking about alternative ion propulsion systems. But as far as I know, we had to use iodine to fit in this form factor. It's a great question.
Thank you. Are there any more questions from the audience? If not, let's thank our speaker for today, and thank you for such a great talk and this amazing interaction at the end.
Thanks so much for having me.
Thanks so much, Craig. Good luck.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.